Palm Harbor, Wednesday night edition. We are in Hebrews part 23. The night's message title is The New Priesthood. We spent the last five sessions in Melchizedek, but we're going to go on and expand a little bit more in our exposition of Hebrews. I'd like to open us with a word of prayer, please. Sure.
Heavenly Father, we give you all the praise and all the glory. We are so thankful for who you are, the word of God that teaches us, and Lord God, help us just teach it, and let everyone hear it, and help us all appropriate it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. So we've got quite a bit to cover tonight, and where we're going, just to, so you know, we're going to lay a foundation for a theme, a thought process, a lane, if you will. And we're going to be covering a lot of scriptures, some which we've covered before a few times, but we're going to do it again because it lays this foundation we need to recognize. The idea that there is a royal priesthood. There is a priesthood, not the Melchizedekian priesthood, but there is a priesthood that serves him, if you will. And we see that terminology of royal priests and kings and priests and kingdom priests and things like that. And we're going to flesh that out. So just kind of follow the narrative here. So as we start out, just reading that my notes that we put together, we've spent the last five sessions exploring Melchizedek and Jesus Christ being the high priest of God in the order of Melchizedek. Tonight, we're going to explore that lane a bit more. Once we acknowledge and accept that Jesus is indeed the high priest of God, we also find ourselves having to deal with another scriptural truth. We are called to be priests in service to him and the new covenant which he mediates. One of C.S. Lewis's heroes was an old-timer by the name of G.K. Chesterton, and a quote from him says, whatever else is or is not true, this one thing is certain, we are not what we were meant to be. And he was writing this as a Christian, meaning that there is a higher base camp, so to speak.
God bless you.
And so it's... I hope that was her. Okay.
The hues are back.
Follow the sneezes.
Right,
they're in
exactly.
town.
Exactly. If you hear sneezes, it's the hues.
Anyway, so what we're going to do, we're going to be covering some scriptures that we've covered before, but basically we're getting into a deeper teaching in Hebrews chapter 7. Chapter 5 and chapter 6 basically leads into this and encouraging all of us and the readers of the time to not settle where they're at, but to continue to grow to those more mature things of the faith. And then we run right into chapter 7, we run right into the story of Melchizedek and Abram and all the things that go with that. So let's talk about the verses again, we can read those. And again, this is building a case. This is a mature teaching. This is a different type of teaching, but you're up for the task here tonight, folks. That's why you're here on Wednesday and watch. Is that, okay, look at this. I want you to look at this. It doesn't mean, I get it, doesn't mean you're going to like run with it and say, oh, yeah, but I want you to consider this.
Because I'm building. Meditate on it. Think about it.
Yeah, it's, you know, I've been in this pool for several weeks pretty deep, and it's like, this is just how I see this. And I may be wrong. If that's the case, pray for me, but I believe there's merit in what we're going to present. Let's go ahead and start reading out of Hebrews, please.
Hebrews 5, 13 and 14. For everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But solid food belongs to those who are of full age, that is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil.
So you see kind of a qualifier here, right? Solid food belongs to who? Those who are full of age, not because you're biologically old, but because you're mature in the faith, if you will. That those who are full of age by what? By reason, who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. That's a sign of maturity, being able to discern good and evil. We live in a world today, at the time we're speaking this, with, you know, Israel and Hamas and all those things going on in the Middle East, which has just started. We do live in a world where some people apparently have some trouble discerning good and evil. You know, those things have blurred quite a bit. I don't mean to get on to that, but that's a perfect example of certain people in the world calling obvious evil good, and that's a crazy thing to bring up. But there's evil in the world. There's evil in the world, and there's good in the world. And we're called to know the difference and not to negotiate with that, as so many churches have today. We keep on dumbing down the faith to be more inclusive and have some type of moral equivalency with anyone, no matter how they live. And that's not what Jesus died for. He died to deliver us from that nonsense, not to help us fit into it. So anyway, it's another story.
Pastor Daly says that true maturity is the consistent practice of the elementary principles.
Yeah.
So if you don't practice those elementary principles, you never get to that true maturity.
It's doing the basics over and over.
Yeah.
I know, Steve, in martial arts,
yeah.
when you had the martial arts studio, I mean, the basics, they have to know the basics of martial arts. You don't just jump to this and do, you got to start the basics and just keep, and those fundamentals have to be there. In strongman competition, the same thing. You got to get used to lifting stones and tire flipping, heavy squats and deadlifts. I mean, you just can't compete unless you're, in Christianity, how do we do that? Well, we do that, I believe, by drawing closer to God and have a better understanding of His will for our lives. We have a better understanding of His word, rightly dividing it. And we're growing in that. Why? Because it's a goal to grow, right? If we set our eyes on Christ, by definition, we will grow more like Him, provided we're sincere in our efforts and our hearts are pure. Let's go ahead and read that next one, please.
Hebrews 6, 1 through 3. So let us stop going over the basic teachings about Christ again and again. Let us go on instead and become mature in our understanding. Surely we don't need to start again with the fundamental importance of repenting from evil deeds and placing our faith in God. You don't need further instruction about baptism, laying on of hands, the resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment. And so, God willing, we will move forward to further understanding.
So, again, the writer gives us some basics here. He just says, you know, we don't need to go over these things over and over again. You can't live there. Those are the foundational things. Those are great. But we need to move forward further to further understanding, to open our understanding of Scripture and God's plan. And then we read just a few verses later in Hebrews 6 that this hope we have is an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, which enters the presence behind the veil. This is language speaking of basically our hope that's being presented to us in God's infallibility and His promises, and He cannot lie in this covenant He's made, but also with Jesus Christ being the forerunner of our faith, if you will. He has paid the price. He's established that new covenant, and He is behind the veil in the Holy of Holies. Matter of fact, later in Hebrews, it says His flesh is the veil.
Yes.
And that this Jesus has become a high priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. And then in Hebrews 7:21, right after that, he says the same thing. The Lord has taken an oath and will not break His vow. You are a priest forever. So we've talked about that quite a bit. Jesus Christ is that high priest. The old covenant and all the things with it, that has been fulfilled and that has been set aside. This is a new high priest, a new covenant, and all the things come with it. Let's go ahead and read Hebrews 8, please.
Hebrews 8, 1 and 2. Here is the main point. We have a high priest who sat down in the place of honor beside the throne of the majestic God in heaven. There he ministers in the heavenly tabernacle, the true place of worship that was built by the Lord and not by human hands. You know, the Old Testament priests, they never sat down in the temple. They had to stand the whole time and do their priestly duties. The thing with Jesus is that everything is finished, it's final, and He sits down next
to the
Father.
Yes. Amen. He ministers. He ministers in the heavenly temple. That means something. What does it mean? He ministers in the heavenly temple. I think it means quite a bit. Let's go ahead and read our next one.
Hebrews 8, 6. But now Jesus, our high priest, has been given a ministry that is far superior to the old priesthood. For He is the one who mediates for us a far better covenant with God based on better promises.
And continue on if we can. Hebrews 10.
Hebrews 10, 15 through 16. And the Holy Spirit also testifies that this is so. For He says, "This is the new covenant I will make with my people on that day, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds."
You know, it's interesting, because now we see the mention of the Holy Spirit. This is a lot of Trinitarian language here in Hebrews, by the way. You just got to look. And the Holy Spirit testifies. He says, this is the new covenant I'll make with my people. I'll put my laws in their hearts and I'll write them on their minds. This is kind of an interesting litmus test, by the way. I just was made aware of that this week. Have you ever thought about that? Okay, we see that. I'm going to make a covenant. I will put my laws in their hearts and I'll write them on their minds. Does that describe you? Is his word just in there all the time? Are you thinking about that all the time? Because that's what this is kind of talking about. Because this is what he says. I will put my laws in their hearts. I'll write them on their minds. It's not like just, you know, magically this happens. This happens through a relationship as we grow in him and that fruit of the Holy Spirit, as we grow in our understanding of his word, as we seek him. I believe there's an impartation of this, if you will. But anyway, I don't want to get off on that, but it's an interesting thing that you ask yourself.
It'll be coming up so we can cover it in more detail.
Yes, I know. Yes, true. Let's go ahead and go to the next one. Sorry.
Hebrews 10:19-22. Therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest of the by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he consecrated for us through the veil, that is his flesh, and having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water.
So, you know, here's an interesting thing here, is that you see this, and again, we got a lot to cover, I can't tarry here long, but we're to have a boldness, you know, not an arrogance, but we're to have a confidence and a boldness along with a reverence and an awe and humility. Bundle those all together, and that's kind of how this works. You come before him, and we do that with boldness. Why? Because Jesus has paid that. He is the one who has paved the way for that very event to happen. Without the blood of Jesus, there is no counsel with God. Without the blood of Jesus, you cannot approach the throne of God. Without the blood of Jesus, you have no relationship with God. But we see that since we do have that relationship by accepting Jesus Christ and his broken body and shed blood, that we see now we're invited. We're actually, in a way, encouraged and told, in a way, having boldness to enter. You know, and that's what we should. Let's draw near with full assurance. Full assurance. John Stott writes that although reconciliation is an event, reconciliation being when one believes upon Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior, repents and receives forgiveness of their sins, and they're regenerate, reborn at that moment of time. His righteousness is imputed to them, if you will. And we check all those boxes and get all those things right. Theologically, what Stott is talking about, access is the continuing relationship to which it leads. That's what we're looking to do. We spend a lot of time, and rightfully so, upon the moment of salvation. What this is talking about in this priestly language is one that facilitates continual relationship, continual access. And then let's look at Hebrews 13:10.
We have an altar from which those who serve the tabernacle have no right to eat.
Now this is an interesting verse, right? So I take this, there's different ways that you can look at this. That verse. You can look at it as in terms of a sacrificial worship viewpoint, that it means there's a contrast between the Old Testament way of worship centered around the tabernacle and the temple and the new covenant established through Christ, and the altar mentioned here, you know, refers to the spiritual altar of Christ's sacrifice on the cross. It also can speak to the Lord's table, communion, Lord's Supper. In this interpretation, the altar refers to the table where the bread and wine are consecrated and shared as Christ's body and blood. Those who serve the tabernacle could be seen as the priests or ministers of the Old Testament system who do not have the right to partake in the spiritual nourishment and communion that believers experience through the bread and wine. And the third view, and there's probably more, but another one is exclusive access to God viewpoint, meaning that through faith in Christ, believers have direct access to God and his blessings symbolized by the altar. And again, the tabernacle represents the old covenant and all those things represent. I tend to embrace all three of these. I think when we talk about what we found out with Melchizedek in Genesis chapter 14 and, of course, studying Hebrews 7, we see that there is a protocol that we were given where Melchizedek went out to meet Abraham. He brought bread and wine, blessed him, and basically blessed God, and then Abraham responded with the tenth. So we see kind of an outline of how that Melchizedekian
interaction
happens, because that's the only example you got. So you've got to kind of look at that for what it is. But when he says this, that we have an altar, that we have an altar from which those who serve the tabernacle have no right to eat. And if we look at that, and I believe we can do that in part as the Lord's table, as an example, because that's one of those things that were given to us as an example, the body and blood of Christ, but I believe ongoing participation in that, the bread and the wine, because as often as you do this in remembrance of me, and there's a lot to that we'll get into. But we have an altar from which those who serve the tabernacle have no right to eat. So we as Christians, as that royal priesthood.
Sorry, and this was ongoing at the time. Mm-hmm. The priests were still in the tabernacle at this time when it was written. Afterwards, that's when the tabernacle was destroyed.
Right, this was about probably 10 years prior to 70.
So this was very relevant for him to say something like this, and I'm sure it took people back.
Yes, it does. Let's look at your quote here from the Biblical Illustrator.
Oh, I thought this was, again, the humanity of Christ. From Biblical Illustrator says, concerning the Lord's Supper, it is the dying wish of the best of friends. You cannot disregard it and be true to him. So Jesus, he knows he's about to die. He's about to go to the cross. He's about to become that sacrifice. And he's among friends. He says this, right? And he says, do this in remembrance of me. Can you imagine the disciples after all this was happening, after it happened? They had to think back. What did Jesus tell us to do? Do this in remembrance of me. And I just thought that was a really great way to look at it. If anyone is having trouble, you know, taking the sacraments at home, the bread right. and the wine at home, you just have to remember this. This is what Jesus wants us to do.
Yeah, and that's, we're going to lean into that quite a bit because, you know, I'm pretty convinced of this at this point, that the Lord's Supper, the Lord's table, the bread and the wine, that has been lost in the traditions of organized churches, et cetera, and we've talked about that before. But we need, the Lord keeps bringing back to this, we need to revive that practice in our daily lives. That's the way it started, that's the way it was the first few hundred years of the church, and then it got kind of, you know, delegated to the powers that be, and then basically lost forever, except for institutional, you know, in the churches, in the church that does the Eucharist or communion, and now, of course, on this side of the Reformation, there's all different ways to do that. I'm not going to have a go at the churches again tonight. I am going to have a go with I'm going to have a teaching with the people. Okay, if you believe in Jesus Christ, by definition, you are a royal priest. Okay, that is a position and title you hold. It doesn't mean you go around telling everybody you're a priest, but that is your core. Because everything you do from that moment on, you will always do it as a priest, serving your high priest in the order of Melchizedek, Jesus Christ. And he calls us to come in. And we see that he's given us these things he's given us these tools. He's given us, we know to pray, we know to read the word, we know baptism is important, we know being filled with the Holy Spirit is important, we know all these things. But yet when it comes to the bread and the wine, the Lord's Supper, the Lord's table, that has been moved away. And we are moving it back.
Yeah.
This is something that we need to implement and practice and own, just like we would own, if you will, the idea of Bible study and prayer and those different types of things, mm-hmm. and praise and worship, because it's in that same lane, things that we're given, things that are ours. But and again, when he talks about this, we have an altar from which those who have served the tabernacle have no right to eat. There's also those people who have no right to eat if they're not believers in Christ. They have no right to eat at the Lord's table. That's why
until
the Hebrews,
they accept Jesus as their Lord and
until
Savior.
Until they accept Jesus, it doesn't matter. Right? You're exactly right. This is for those people in that priesthood. You can't just jump in. But that's why it says examine yourself. And we have an Old Testament example, and I don't want to lean too much on this because that's when we start getting a little, you know, I don't want to twist it out of context, but it was an important thing to do it the right way in the Old Testament. Let's go ahead and read that.
Numbers 18:7. But you and your sons, the priests, must personally handle all the priestly rituals associated with the altar and with everything behind the inner curtain. I am giving you the priesthood as your special privilege of service. Any unauthorized person who comes too near the sanctuary will be put to death.
Now that's in your face. So there must be some bite to that. These are the rules. This is serious, and this is the way the Lord set this up. And you say, well, that's kind of harsh. Well, you're coming into the presence of God under the presumption that you're a Christian, and he's saying, be careful here. You know, this is a special thing you're doing. And just examine yourself. So we say, well, that's Old Testament. It can't be that serious today. Well, 1 Corinthians actually does lean into that. Let's read this one.
11:27-31. So anyone who eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord unworthily is guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. That is why you should examine yourself before eating the bread and drinking the cup. For if you eat the bread or drink the cup without honoring the body of Christ, you are eating and drinking God's judgment upon yourself. That is why many of you are weak and sick, and some have even died. But if we would examine ourselves, we would not be judged by God in this way.
Okay, so you look at this passage, and basically all the ministers and theologians begin to roll dice and say what that means. It doesn't mean that. Everybody come. Well, there's this whole dying part and sick part. I mean, does that mean anything? I mean, there's a litmus test there. And he's saying, okay, this is good, but you need to examine yourself, because if you do this in an unworthy manner, then there's going to be some issues, right? And that's his words. And we can try to be politically and socially and religiously correct and dumb this down, and I'm going to kind of give you the end of that. You're wrong, because this is a warning for purpose. It's not accidentally. This is here for real, and we need to pay attention to it. Why? Because the Lord's Supper is a special time. The Lord's table is a special time. You're entering behind the veil. You're entering to the Holy of Holies. As you go with that, that's as intimate as it can be, because you're basically, well, we'll get into this. I'm sorry. Let's go to the next passage. I'm building the case. Let's go.
First Peter 2, 4 and 5. You are coming to Christ, who is the living cornerstone of God's temple. He was rejected by people, but he was chosen by God for great honor. And you are living stones that God is building into his spiritual temple. What's more, you are his holy priest. Through the mediation of Jesus Christ, you offer spiritual sacrifices that please God.
Okay, so now Peter begins to flesh this out just a little bit in his circular writings, right? So you are living stones that God is building. Building into what? Into his spiritual temple. What's more? You are his holy priest. Okay, if you stop right there, what is the lens you put on that statement? You are his holy priest. What does that mean? It's a fair question, right?
Yeah, do we remember it?
Well, and then we, through the mediation of Christ, we offer spiritual sacrifices. Now, we kind of get our head wrapped around more about that, because we can talk about spiritual sacrifices. That's more common ground, I believe, more familiar. The idea that you're his holy priest, a little bit different. But Paul adds on to this too. And again, if we look at the whole counsel of Scripture, we can see the various writers saying much the same things, but in adding to each other to flesh out the whole story. Let's read 1 Corinthians.
6:19-20. Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own? For you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. 2 Corinthians 6:16. And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk among them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people.
And 1 Peter, we'll pull right back into that, if you don't mind.
2:9-10. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who had obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy.
So what have we just learned here? Because we want to keep this... You've got to look at this through the Melchizedek priesthood, Melchizedekian priesthood. Why is that? When I try it, I can't do it.
I know.
When you look at it through the lens of Jesus in the order of the priesthood in the order of Melchizedek, and you look at us, then you say, okay, The old covenant, there was a high priest, and there was hundreds or thousands of priests all over the land, right? Not a high priest, but there were priests basically representing the, you know, the Lord and all that they were doing. Well, now we have a new high priest and a new way of doing things. And a fair question is, okay, where's all the priests? If he's a high priest, where's all the priests? It'd be a fair question. Well, if you're a high priest, where's the priest? And that has been not talked about a lot, but I believe what we see here quite clearly is that we are those priests. You are his holy priest. And what's more, your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. And so glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's, belong to God. And he says that you are the temple of the living God. I will dwell in them and walk among them. And that goes perfectly with the idea that I will write my laws on your hearts and minds, doesn't it? Because the Holy Spirit lives within us, and I will dwell in them and walk among them, and that we're a chosen, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood. I mean, goodness, I don't know. We look at this holy priest and the temple of the Holy Spirit, his own special people, chosen generation, royal priesthood. And then Matthew 5:14, that language that goes with this, you're the light of the world. Ephesians 5:8, you were once darkness, but now you are the light in the Lord. Walk as children of the light. Think about that from a priestly lens. Okay, you are my representatives. As Jesus speaking to us as our high priest, you are my representatives. He tells us to go, and we know all those scriptures, and yes, but I want to dig in a little bit deeper here about specifically what we find with Melchizedek and Abraham given to us as an example of how this plays out with this new high priest in the order of Melchizedek and the priests that would go with that whole imagery. They must be there somewhere, and we see their names mentioned. And what does that mean to us?
You know, the Bible uses several images for Christians. It says you are salt, light, branches, the temple of God, and even, like we just read, living stones that God is building into his temple. Amen. In 1 Peter, the imagery is taken to another level when it not only includes the symbolism, but also describes the position that we have in Christ's kingdom. We are holy priests, a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, his own special people. The new priesthood is more than just a good allegory. It's more than just what we think is, oh, that's just imagery. It is a promotion from the darkness we were in to now being holy, chosen, special, and royal. These images are relational and representative. For the one who has put us in this position of priest, our high priest, Jesus Christ. As we study more about the priesthood, let's remember it's more than just imagery. It's our position in the kingdom of God.
Well,
which we shouldn't ever be going out all mealy-mouthed and docile. We should never do that. We should always have the confidence of Christ in us. You know?
Well, I think in a world that's looking for answers, it's probably okay to be confident that you have one, that I do have that answer, Jesus
Christ.
Because
what do priests do? They bless the people. They teach the law. They do all these things. They're busy about the Lord's work.
Right. And John expands on this in the book of Revelation many, many years later. Let's go ahead and read those next two passages.
Revelation 1:6, he has made us a kingdom of priests for God his Father. All glory and power to him forever and ever. Amen. Revelation 12:11, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives to the death.
Now, you get in trouble here connecting too many verses. You can connect a bunch of verses and kind of make whatever kind of book you want, right? But I think it's fair to say here in 1:6, he says he's made us a kingdom of priests for God his Father. Okay? That seems to go in the same lane of things we've been talking about, right? And then he talks about later on how they were victorious and what these kingdom priests were victorious. How did they win that thing? How did they get out of this? We find this. They overcame him by what? The blood of the Lamb. What better thing for a royal priest to be proclaiming than the priest of than the blood of their of Jesus Christ, their high priest, who shed his blood for us? That's the whole purpose of this. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by what?
The word of their testimony.
The word of our testimony. A priest should be talking about what they believe. At the very least, you should be talking about what you represent. At the very least, we should do that. And then we go exactly on into Hebrews 13, which tells us this.
Therefore, by him, let us continually offer the sacrifice of praise to God. That is, the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. But do not forget to do good and to share, for with such sacrifices, God is well pleased.
Okay. Now, what we're going to do is take another journey. Is everybody with us so far? No one's walked out yet. A couple have started to. They stuck with it. Thank you. Now, when we talk about, I'm going to go back to the Lord's Supper. Okay? I'm going back to the Lord's table. Why? Because we need to go there. When we talk about partaking of the bread and wine, we partake of the body and blood of Christ. That's a moment in time when we accept Christ. We're born again. Our sins have been washed away. We've transferred from a kingdom of darkness to a kingdom of light. Our name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And we check all those theological boxes that, yes, this is legit, right? I'm a born-again believer. Praise God. We're good. But then we look at the bread and the wine as it applies to what we're talking about in terms of that priestly imagery, partaking of the Lord's table, and Jesus fleshes that out even more, obviously. You know, take and eat. This is my body, and this is my blood, and this is the new covenant. This is my, and he gives us that the facts of what that represents, and then he gives us example of how to institute or consecrate the elements for that, as does Paul in the Corinthian letters. But when we talk about Jesus, and when we start to look at Jesus in the lens of a high priest, when he says, "Do this in remembrance of me," what we've done for the last several hundred years, we've turned the Lord's table into a funeral. It's a memorial event, and that's what it is. It's a memorial event, and I'm going to challenge you to rethink that, because I think it needs to be rethought. We got to look at, okay, do this in remembrance of me. Okay, what did Jesus as my high priest, what did he do that's talked about throughout Hebrews, what did he do to be able to be put in that position? So let's find a little bit more, because the Old Testament talks a lot about this. Let's go to Isaiah, and we'll start in Isaiah. We've got a few verses to cover, so hang with me, but listen to what's being said and start to connect the dots.
Isaiah 53:3-6. He was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows, acquainted with deepest grief. We turned our backs on him and looked the other way. He was despised and we did not care. Yet it was our weaknesses he carried. It was our sorrows that weighed him down. And we thought his troubles were a punishment from God, a punishment for his own sins. But he was pierced for our rebellion, crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we could be whole. He was whipped so we could be healed. All of us, like sheep, have strayed away. We have left God's paths to follow our own, yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all.
Okay, so let's look at this, because this is talking about our high priest. He was pierced for our rebellion, okay, crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we could be whole. Okay, that gets, read a little bit more into that, right? But then he says this, he was whipped so we could be healed. So I just want to challenge you on this. As we partake at the Lord's table and do this in remembrance of him, understand that when you do this in remembrance of him, it's not simply remembering him dying, but remembering all of this, because this is what was happening when he did that. This is all in the package. And I don't mean to dumb that down or compartmentalize it too much, but this is what it says. He was crushed for our sins, yes. He was beaten so we could be whole, yes. And he was whipped so we could be healed. What does that mean? Well, This is part of what is
of
in that new covenant.
That
I don't know how
promised.
You get around that, because that is, we do this in remembrance of me. Well, when you do this in remembrance of what Jesus did, well, that's more than just, there's more to that.
Yes.
And then we've missed that. Let's go on to our next
and
one.
And that's where it can become ritual. If you
yes.
just say the verses, you just take the bread, you just drink the wine, and then that's it. That can be a ritual. But what we're encouraging you to do is to make it fellowship. Make it a prayer time. Make it a proclamation time. Jesus, you were beaten so I could be whole. You were whipped so that I could be healed. And I thank you for my healing.
Yeah, and, you know, we talked about the examination thing earlier and, you know, the potential death sentence there that's given to us, right? But, you know, for people that abuse it, and some people, apparently there are people who can be on the wrong side of that so much that God says, you need to be careful here because I'm not playing. Any way you cut it, that's kind of what it's saying. For us that love the Lord, I want you to take a different lens on this. And I think the lens that's easiest perhaps to think about is, for me in a way, is a marriage relationship. Do I love her and am I faithful? And yes, I love her and I am faithful. Does that mean that I never have to say I'm sorry? No, I did that. Was that this morning or yesterday?
Right. It was a rough week.
Tough week.
We both said
That does not mean that. See, so look at that as a falling short. As in a Christian walk, you sin and fall down, but then you ask the Lord to forgive you. And it's never been a question that you're divorced and leaving home.
Right.
I love the Lord and I'm faithful to the Lord, but Lord, forgive me for this. You know, and because you have that, we have a relationship.
Yes.
But if when you look at the Lord's table from afar, you're looking at it as a strange woman. Well, I don't know her. It's like, you know, No. If you're really married, if you're really in that relationship, yes, I'm coming to eat with you. Mm-hmm. And I love you. And mm-hmm. yes, I've been faithful. And I've had a tough week, but I'm here. Mm-hmm. And that's what we look at in that relationship. But if you don't have that relationship where you know, then it's like, ooh, what do I do? And you got to be careful how you play that. Because
and even if you don't have that relationship with the Lord right now, either you're new or this is all new to you, you practice, right? You practice those elementary things. You come before the Lord and you are honest with him because he already knows your heart. He already knows how you feel. He already knows everything, every thought that went through your head right before
you
came.
He says that in Hebrews 5, the word of God's, all powerful in this. And he says he knows everyone's naked in his sight.
Yes.
He gives account. He knows everything anyway.
Yes.
So we're not playing God by
and
trying to.
And he's a good father. He wants the best for you. It's not the image that the world wants to give you, that he's this person up here waiting to knock you on the head for something.
Yeah,
that's
let's get
not
on the other
it.
Side of that. And I apologize for being a bit negative on that, because it's pretty bitey, and I am pretty bitey on it, because Scripture's pretty. Anytime it says if you don't do this right, there's people who are dying, probably need to pay attention to that one, because that is a New Testament thing. But let's get past that.
Yeah.
And let's talk about those of us that, we examine ourselves, but yes, I want to dine with him. I know, I love him. I mean, yes, I'm serving him. And I'm faithful to him, and I love it. And so let's look at from that lens. Okay, that's me. Okay, I'm not Okay, as we get that boldness, know who we are in Christ. For those of us who've accepted him, then we have that relationship where you truly love him and you're truly faithful to him. And then the Lord's table is given to you. And here's something I want you to think about. By having that stolen away from us for hundreds of years. I firmly believe that when we partake and participate and practice the Lord's table, not only are we doing that in remembrance of him and thanksgiving, but there's also an impartation to us. There's no act that you do that God is not, there's reciprocity in everything you do with the Lord. When you pray, there's reciprocity. When you study the word, there's reciprocity. When you give to him, there's reciprocity. Even when you're praying in the spirit, there are things happening. When we ignore something he's given us to do, I believe we miss an impartation that's due us, that was always there, but was taken away. The gift of the Holy Spirit was always there. But you didn't hear about it until the beginning of the 20th century, the Azusa Street Revival, where when you say, well, the church got by just fine without it, I would submit to you the church gets by better with the baptism of the Holy Spirit than without it. That's just me. I also believe the church will do far better. The people will do far better to give you the boldness and the empowerment back that was taken because of traditions of men to get at the Lord's table as often as you can. It's like saying, well, how often should I have a private meal with my wife? Once a week? Once a month? How often should we get together? I don't want this to become a ritual. Right. I don't want to get to know you too well. I might get used to that, and it's going to be a ritual. Think how silly this is. We're looking at it the wrong way. It is a relationship.
It is.
The perfect relation, the perfect prayer that we'll see in the Bible, really, it's not a prayer at all. It's when God walked with Adam in the garden just talking. That, think about what I'm saying. That was God's original plan. And we need to implement those things that we've been given to have that relationship. And he says, this altar is not for everybody. This is for you. And don't anyone just jump. No, not anyone's just going to sit with my wife and have dinner with her. Make sure you know who you are. Not anyone's just going to come into the Lord's presence, the Holy of Holies of all places, and just be a poser because God said, don't do that. However, if you love me, and even if you've been a dope, but you still love me, I can work with that.
Yes,
okay?
Absolutely.
I can work with that. Don't let your pride keep you away. Don't be afraid to come. That's the whole point. First question, do you love Jesus? If you can say yes, then yeah. Then let's play this out scripturally. If you don't know Jesus and don't love Jesus,
even if you're trying to love Jesus, let's say you're still really new in the faith, if you're just trying to love Jesus, he knows that too. I mean, just say it. Lord, I'm trying to love you more. There we go.
Let's go on to our next one here.
Yes.
Isaiah 55.
Isaiah 55, 1 through 3. Everyone who
go ahead. I'm sorry.
Everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and you who have no money, come buy and eat. Yes, come buy wine and milk without money and without price. Why do you spend money for what is not bread, and your wages for what does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me, and eat what is good, and let your soul delight itself in abundance. Incline your ear and come to me. Hear, and your soul shall live, and I will make an everlasting covenant with you.
So again, this is, if we look at this from the lens that this is written in, this is about intimacy. Come. Come.
Have a relationship.
You've got the God of all creation. I mean, aren't you special? You've got the God of all creation saying, come. I want you to be with me. I want your time. I want your fellowship. And I mean, there's no higher calling. And he's showing us how to do this. In the next passage, seek the Lord while you can find him. Call on him now while he is near. It says, turn to our God, for he will forgive generously.
Yes.
I mean, don't try to work yourself up into a place that you can feel you have some merit. No, the whole point is to finally someday realize there's nothing you can do except ask God's forgiveness and ask him into your heart. And that's all free.
Yep.
That's a conversation. It needs to be one from the heart, but it's a conversation. And until we get to that place, then we go no further. There has to be a place that you recognize you need a Savior. And the whole point of having a Savior is that Savior can do something you cannot do. You cannot reconcile yourself as a sinful, finite, sinful human being. You have no way to approach God. How do you do that? Yell at the sky? I mean, what do you do? The only way you have is Jesus Christ. He's the way, the truth, and life. No one comes to the Father but through him. And this language all points to that. Then let's go to our next passage here.
Isaiah 55, 8 through 9. My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, says the Lord, and my ways are far beyond anything you can imagine. For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. Isaiah 55, 10 through 11. As the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, and do not return there, but water the earth and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it.
Now I'm going to go ahead. I'm sorry.
I was just going to say, it's saying that he wants his word to go forth, and it will not return void. But there is something that came to my mind that would stop that from happening. And it's the traditions of men. In Matthew 15:6, it says, Jesus said, you can make the word of God of no effect by your tradition. What happens if this is a tradition? What happens if you sit back and go, okay, God, I hear all this teaching. I don't believe it. I'm just going to wait till, you know, Sunday morning at church, the first Sunday of the month, and I'm only going to do it then. That's a tradition.
Yeah, it is.
That's a tradition.
When he says his word, and again, you got to be careful on this, because you can kind of make some of these verses mean whatever you want, right? And that's irresponsible. We try not to do that here. That being said, he says this here. He says, you know, my thoughts aren't your thoughts. My ways are far beyond anything you can imagine. So when you think about the bread and the wine at the Lord's table, when you think about that, when you bless it, then when you consecrate, lay, you speak God's word over it to establish the Lord's table. You are a royal priest in the presence of your high priest. You're also accompanying, you are the temple of the Holy Spirit who's there with you, and our high priest just happens to be at the right hand of God the Father. So you have some Trinitarian language here going on for you theologians. You can't get around that. But he says, my thoughts are not like your thoughts, and my ways are far beyond anything you can do. He says, my word will go forth, and it will not return to me void. It shall accomplish what I please. I wonder how that would apply to take and eat, this is my body and this is my blood. I wonder how that applies when we speak God's consecration, his blessing over the bread and wine as we partake in the Lord's table, if you will, the Lord's Supper. Because I believe that as we do that, it will not return to him void. As you pronounce God's word over that, that is established in the Lord's table. And as you take and eat, there's a recognition, remembrance, and a reverence, but there is absolutely an impartation there. There's an impartation that we miss.
And that's the mystery.
That's the mystery. And you say, okay, what does that mean? Well, it means that I don't know that we fully know what it means, okay? And I'm just saying, oh, well, that's not a very good teacher. Well, okay, I get
it.
For
being honest.
The simple truth is, it's been shuffled away for centuries, and at least for us, in a sense, rediscovered. And so I'm not for sure what all comes with it. I do know this. Let me put it like this to you. Okay, he's given us physical things to touch. Pray this over the bread and
tangible
wine.
Things.
This is my body and this is my blood. And it's a serious thing to do because we see the warnings. Don't do this in a stupid way. Do it the right way because there's blessing there. It's a time of intimacy. It's a time of closeness with your Father, with your high priest. You're the temple of the Holy Spirit. You are a royal priest doing priestly things. Act priestly. That's what we do because you're going in the presence of that high priest. And then we see that as we do that, everything else launches from that. But that impartation, I think that we've missed that impartation, is that tangible I was talking about. There's remember the woman with the issue of blood who did what?
Touched the hem of the garment.
Touched his robe. There's that point of contact. Could she have been healed without touching the robe? I suppose Jesus did that too. But there's a story there. She had the faith to touch the robe. And was there anything imparted when she touched part of him?
Yes, because Jesus said, I feel virtue leading me.
Is there any impartation that can happen as we're obedient and partake of the bread and the body and the blood of Christ? Not simply for his recognition of what he has done. That could have been done without giving the sacraments at all. Just remember me. But no. He gives us point of contact. Because that point of contact is that point, I believe, that would include that impartation, just like touching that robe. Is it a means only of healing? No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying it's a lane that we haven't traveled enough in to know because it's been hidden. It's like when the early Pentecostals, what's it going to be filled with the Holy Spirit? What are we going to do? Well, the tongue-talking thing was real popular, but then we see that fleshed out, didn't it? It matured, and it grew as we grew of our understanding of that Pentecostal experience. This is the same thing in my mind. I think I know, but I'm in all honesty, I'm in this part of the pool, and I'm going to stay here for a while because this deserves my attention. As a teacher and a theologian, this deserves my attention and your attention. You say, well, what if it's okay to do this all the time? How do we know? Well, in the New Testament, they did. The first 350 years of the church, they absolutely did. House to house in their homes and also corporately.
Yes.
It wasn't either or, it was both.
Yes.
And I can tell you which one was being done the most, the one from house to house every day in people's lives. Just like how often you pray more on your own, you pray more in church. Or on your own. You read more of the Bible on your own or more at church, like on Wednesday nights. I see some of you. But no, it's you see the point here. Let's go ahead and read some
Isaiah 58:6-11. No, this is the kind of fasting I want. Free those who are wrongly imprisoned. Lighten the burden of those who work for you. Let the oppressed go free and remove the chains that bind people. Share your food with the hungry and give shelter to the homeless. Give clothes to those who need them, and do not hide from relatives who need your help. Then your salvation shall come like the dawn, and your wounds will quickly heal. Your godliness will lead you forward, and the glory of the Lord will protect you from behind. And then when you call, the Lord will answer, yes, I am here. He will quickly reply, remove the heavy yoke of oppression, stop pointing your finger and spreading vicious rumors. Feed the hungry and help those in trouble. Then your light will shine out from the darkness, and the darkness around you will be as bright as noon. The Lord will guide you continually, giving you water when you are dry and restoring your strength. You will be like a well-watered garden, like an ever-flowing spring.
Okay, so we're not talking about fasting. Why are we talking about fasting here? This is not about fasting. This is about the condition of the heart that God's looking for. Okay, so we see priestly imagery here. So if you need to know in your mind, well, how does a priest live in terms of this new covenant? We're looking at this whole part of Isaiah, which is pointing towards this very thing. And he talks about how we are to live our lives. Free those who are wrongly imprisoned. Lighten the burden. As a priest of the Most High God, you are to talk about your high priest, Jesus Christ, the Savior of mankind, right? The creator of all heavens and the earth, but you're also there as a shining light. Remember, you're the light of the world and all these types of imageries we talked about earlier. He also says to lighten the burden, lighten people's burdens, let the oppressed go free, remove the chains that bind people. Okay, now again, when you look at this in the natural, it makes no sense. Like, what does that, I don't see anybody with chains. What's this even mean? When you look at it through the eyes of a Christian as a priest serving our high priest, you know exactly what this means. Mm-hmm. Priests are to help relieve the burden, to provide answers and hope, to help one realize that they were created for something greater, something more noble, something that is eternal. People have purpose. They are to have identity. They are to have love and intimacy with God, their creator and father. And you see all those, this whole list of things that describe in my mind what we should represent. And you're saying, well, that was just for them. Well, not really, because Jesus says the very same thing out of Isaiah about himself. Let's read that.
Isaiah 61, 1-2. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me, for the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to comfort the brokenhearted and to proclaim that captives will be released and prisoners will be freed. He has sent me to tell those who mourn that the time of the Lord's favor has come, and with it the day of God's anger against their enemies.
You see any overlap there? Mm-hmm. Yes.
Well, even he tells us in the scriptures, feed the hungry, clothe the poor, all of that. That's throughout the scriptures. And can I cover quickly
Please. This
one thing where it says, you know, you're doing all this, but he says, then your salvation will come like a dawn and your wounds will quickly heal. Your godliness will lead you forward. So your salvation, maybe that's your confidence in the Lord. Your wounds will quickly heal. That's a great promise. And then your godliness, you are growing more in godliness as you're doing this.
Well, and that was the whole thing we talked about. Like when you see the order, when you see Melchizedek interacting with Abram, you see, I mean, it's just what it is. You see a sequence of events and you say, okay, that's a snapshot. Click. That's it. That's that interaction between the high priest and the priest to come, because the old priesthood and the high priest being removed, set aside, the new high priest is here, and we see these examples given throughout Scripture on how one's to live a life. Matter of fact, Isaiah 61:6 says, you know, interesting, you shall be named the priests of the Lord. They shall call you the servants of our God.
We should write that, and I mean, mine's already highlighted, but we should highlight it like, okay, reminder every day. We shall be named the priests of the Lord. They shall call you the servants of God. We're not only a servant of God. I think we as Christians always say, oh, we're a servant of the Lord. You know, we serve the Lord.
And he's not talking about the Levitical priesthood here, too.
No,
he's
not.
This is a prophetic time
to come.
This is future,
yes. But also, I am a priest of the Lord. So
yeah.
As I walk out that door, or as I spend my time at the house, because a lot of us are homebodies and working from home, that it makes it helps us to remember, okay, as I live my life daily, you know, I am a priest of the Lord. I am not only a servant, but I am a priest of the Lord.
Right, and you have to, I think it does you good to recognize the well, let me back up. I guess this is who you're called to be, okay? When we get in Hebrews 5, and particularly in 6, then the encouragement is to move on to the deeper things, the more mature things. His words, not mine. Bang, we end up right where we're at, okay? Okay, what's so difficult about this? It's Melchizedek and all this stuff. Well, okay, right? Okay, so it's a little bit more intricate than you think. But we've spent a fair amount of time, and I think everyone here probably knows a bit more about Melchizedek than what they did before they got here, because we've spent a lot of time in that. And so you look at this, what does it mean to be a priest of God? Okay, I'm a pastor and a teacher. That's one of the fivefold ministry, church gifts to the church in Ephesians. I don't always feel like a teacher, and I don't always act like a pastor. And most of you know that, but yet you're here, so that kind of speaks of your love or your dysfunction. Pick one. But I have to remind myself, and I do, because I had an old timer tell me this, and I learned that you always want to respect the office to which you've been called. You always dress the part, and I don't mean that in a hypocritical way. Just realize you're called to teach. You remember that. It doesn't matter how you feel that day. You're a teacher for the Lord. You're a pastor. Just because you don't feel like it, you need to have respect for that office, because that's an office I've put you in. In terms of being a royal priest or a priest, you're looking for, again, this is where everything comes from that. Okay, your purpose, your ministry. Understand something. I want you to get this. Your strength will be found in your obedience. Listen to that. Your strength will be found in your obedience. And that's for somebody somewhere, because the Lord laid that in my heart. Strength is found in obedience. He's calling us to obey. When we get to Hebrews chapter 11,
oh yeah.
Why are those people there? They all obeyed.
They all obeyed.
He obeyed. He
they
heard and obeyed.
Did not
he obeyed.
Love their lives
he obeyed.
To,
he obeyed.
To the death.
Okay. When we start talking about when we get later on, we're going to see that there's more to that than just, oh, I have faith. Do you now? We are supposed to, and we're given these examples. But I think there's a higher base camp than what we think. And we're all invited to get on the train and join that journey. He's called you to that. So let's read our next one here.
Hebrews 13:20-21. Now may the God of peace, who brought up our Lord Jesus from the dead, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you complete in every good work to do his will, working in you what is well-pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. That's a proclamation over everyone who's hearing us.
Yes, it is. It is. So the takeaway tonight, as we are closing, and I do mean that, closing, I think the heaviest burden I have to bring is the importance of the Lord's table in your life. I mean that. I think we have, I'm ready to talk to anybody about that. I argue with myself all week. I mean, I'm reading books nonstop, the early church fathers and all the history and all the books on the Eucharist from the Catholics, books from all the different faiths. I buy their books. What do they think? What do they see? And you have to saddle up somewhere. And our position is, I'm going to go biblical with it the best that I can. And since everything gets so distorted pretty quick, I'm going to settle the first 200 or 300 years of the church, coming right out of the New Testament, that second and third generation of Christians who studied under the apostles, or the ones who studied under the ones they learned from. Early, get as close to that orange tree as you can, because the orange juice has become somewhat concentrated and frozen the further we get away from it. I want to get back to the source. And the source gives us clear example of what we should be doing. And we see the early church gives us clear example of what we should be doing, and it's been lost. I'm here to share with you that you need to start implementing that, just like you need to read the Bible and you need to pray. I can say it the same way. You need to practice the Lord's table
like
in your
home.
Like
once a week. Some people can do every day.
Some people do it every day.
A few times a week, but just start with once a week.
And understand that the way that looks, I'm learning this, that when I do the Lord's table, did it three times this week, and that's a record for me. That's just a record. Three times a week, that's a record. But I'm in pursuit. And what I'm finding out is that as I partake of the Lord's table, us together or just by myself, that whole thing there may last 10 or 15 minutes. As we do it in the church, it's pretty much over. It is a meal. That's the way they celebrate it in the early church. And I don't mean a meal in the sense there's a meal that goes that can go with that. But I'm talking about the
idea.
It's
a conversation with the meal, because you rarely have a meal without some type of conversation with somebody.
Use the marriage imagery. If I just sit down and say, okay, we're here, I'm having an appetizer and go, you're going, he really loves me. That's great.
Right.
Did he get the check even? I mean, I don't know. You wouldn't do that, would you?
No.
No, you are there. And so what I've discovered is that as I'm sitting there, and I bless the wine and the
we
bread.
We give thanks first,
and
then we bless it.
Then speak God's word over it to institute the table. And then if we break the bread and eat the bread. And then as we do the same thing biblically for the wine or the fruit
grape
of the vine,
juice,
grape
yeah.
juice. And then you're in that point. And I found, okay, Lord, I'm just talking out loud here because I really did this. What should I do? You say, well, are you in a hurry? I mean, that's kind of the voice that, like, okay, I'm just being serious with you. Because I went to all this trouble to set up the table. We got a date. And it sounds terrible.
Yeah.
I need a pastor on Wednesday night. That one got taken out for being a little too cute. But so when that's an incredibly special time when you reframe
and
it.
And have we gotten warm fuzzies and you know, light from heaven just shown? No, but it's the act of doing it. And we know by faith, the Lord, that we have opened up the avenues for him to just pour his fullness in us. So, yes.
Yeah, so you sit there and you talk.
Yeah.
And I do all the things I've always done. I give him thanks and praise him and thank him for.
I remind him of the covenant and everything he promised for us within that covenant.
Well, it's a conversation.
It is.
And I think that's the whole point.
Yeah.
And you say, okay, Pastor, what are you guys trying to do? Tom and Lori, what are you trying to do here? Trying to facilitate a very, very, very real relationship between you and Jesus Christ.
Yes.
More real in the sense that you're actually setting the table and you're sitting with the bread and wine for maybe a half hour a week or 15 minutes a week or 5 minutes or 10 minutes a day. It's taking time to pray. It's taking time to study God's word. It's taking time to praise and worship him. It's taking time to sit at the table and say, Lord, and I'm just going to tell you something. It takes it up a notch. I'm just telling you, for me to pray, okay, I pray all the time, read the word all the time. For me to sit at the Lord's table, to examine myself, and to pronounce blessing on that, I'm paying pretty close attention. I just am, because there is those things written. And I'm not afraid of that, but I'm not naive. It's like you've just got to stay in the proper lane. And as we do that as faithful to him, then you find out that he's always wanted us there.
Yes.
And there's an impartation. Because as we bless the bread and the wine, it basically that's where the mystery begins.
Yes.
Okay, I'm not going into all the different.
We already did. Yeah.
But that's where the mystery begins. But understand that the bread and wine is no more symbolic than the Israelites getting manna from heaven. They really did get manna from heaven, and it really did accomplish something. They really did have to partake of it, and this is a completely different subject and a bad example, but the point is, it's more than just symbolic. It's more than just symbolic. If it were nothing but symbolism, why is there a death threat attached to it? Think about what I'm saying. If it's just symbolic, it doesn't matter. But if it really means something, have I went too far?
No.
I'm sorry.
No, but they can go back and watch all that.
Yes, I know.
I have covered it. And we want to make sure that we leave it open for anyone listening with Noah.
Yes, we've got to keep it. Please,
his invitation.
Please consider the Lord's table far more than you do, because it is for us. He is our high priest. We are his priest. And I believe that has been somehow sucked away. And as we implement that back, I believe that you can go in there loving him, faithful to him. He wants you there, invites you to come. And I believe there is an exchange that is made, just like there is in anything else we do. There's more to it than just remembering him. There's also, he's empowering us for service as well, I believe. Please, Noah, can you close us out of here tonight before I go too long?
Hey, Wednesday night family. Noah here, and we just finished up our series in Melchizedek last week, but moving forward in Hebrews, I thought it was super cool that we went over, or are beginning to go over, this new priesthood. So I'm super excited to see what God has in store for us, but I'm going to go ahead and close out the service in prayer. I just want to pray a blessing over you guys, so if you would please join me. Dear Heavenly Father, you are holy. And you are the only one worthy. And I just give you thanks right now for this opportunity to gather and to seek after your wisdom and to have it imparted into us. God, I pray that as we go from this place, that knowledge and that wisdom wouldn't dwindle or perish, that it would grow stronger within us, and that we would be able to share it with others, and that it would help strengthen our faith and the faith of others. So Father, I just pray that as we go from this place, that you would bless us, even as we're blessed in our coming, that you would bless us in our going, that you would protect us and keep us safe, that you would give us a deeper hunger for your word, that you would bless us, whether it's financially or spiritually, whatever it is, God. I just pray that your hand would be upon us this week, that we would be able to accomplish things for the kingdom or make advancements for the kingdom this week, because it's all for your name's sake. So in Jesus' name I pray, amen. And if you are new to the church or curious about starting your faith journey and accepting Jesus into your life, then you can either go back to one of our previous videos. At the end, I usually give an altar call. Or if you're in the house tonight and you want to come up to the front, meet with one of the leaders, we'd be more than happy to go over that with you. But if you're online watching, you can go ahead and send an email to noah@newhopepalmharbor.com. You can send prayer requests there, or if you have any questions, or if you're just looking for a point of contact in the church. But we look forward to seeing you next Wednesday, and we hope that you have a wonderful rest of your week. Be blessed.